Welcome back to Dan on Dev as we continue this series about why all AppSec products suck. This episode is going to be focused on the IAST products, the interactive application security testing, or that could be instrumented or integrated. I've seen this over the years, it's kind of evolved. I think it's interactive, I think is probably what the primary term this this year is, or these last couple of years. So we're going to talk about what they are, what they do. Again, this series is not actually so much about why they suck. It's actually about the challenges of each tool, if you understand what they're not good at and you understand what they are good at, then hopefully you can pick the right tool for you, for the job. Every environment's different. How you're building your applications is different. And what your maturity level, the way you guys build your code, all of these things will impact the tools that are going to work for you. Just like you couldn't tell somebody to pick one tool to build a house with, it's probably not going to be successful. And I would say the same for these AppSec products. I really think you need multiple tools ultimately, but we'll get into some of the opinions on what's the best and what's not. I'm trying to avoid opinion, like what's best in this conversation. Maybe at the end we'll have a conclusion where maybe I'll bring in some others and we'll kind of discuss and debate. But I still think you need a mix ultimately. I've spent the last 20 years building a DAST product, which is the one we covered last episode, and went into some detail there. But nonetheless, I think this is just, I just like the solving the problem. I think the challenge is interesting. And so this is why I like looking at all the tools. Again, there's a bunch of tools. There's the static we went through already. DAST went through already. We're on IAST this time around. And we're going to continue the series going through the rest of the alphabet soup of solutions out there. And there's others that are a little more niche, but these are the major ones. So that's why I'm discussing these major ones. So let's talk about IAST. What is it? First, a quick 101. The reason they're called integrated application security testing is because they actually attach to the code. They attach to the running code. So a static analysis is actually looking at like the text files that make up the code, right? So it's reading the book essentially. This is kind of like it's you actually kick it off and have it run. But you're not attacking it from the outside. You're actually watching it from inside. So you're like attaching to this thing, and so it's almost like a hybrid, if you will, of that. It's like in the it's looking at the code. It can kind of see the call stacks. It can see the executions. It sees a lot of what's going on in the code, which is amazing. Like I think it's an awesome technology. It's a great solution. But that's how it's looking at it. It's looking at it from that point of view. Let me actually make this a little, I'm going to switch over to here. But it makes that point of view. So it's really looking at what's going on inside of there. So it's watching it. It's kind of like, and this is why there's integrated or interactive, instrumented. But like I said, it's actually more like this X-ray in that it's watching as the thing is operating, and it's watching inside of the code that's actually running. Very, very cool stuff. The challenges of this. This only works really on interpreted languages. I said this actually at a conference, and Jeff Williams, who has a contrast security, which builds an IaaS product. He said they recently added support for Go, so I'll take that correction. But nonetheless, primarily this really works on instrumented languages. So that means like you're not gonna be able to use it on something that's, I don't know, written in C++. But do you really need to? People aren't building web applications in C++ all that often anyway. So that's not a huge limiter, I would say. That's not a big issue. But it still needs to work in a model where it can actually watch the code that's running. And that limits what languages it'll support. And you have to have support for each language. And that starts to become the problem. Because what if it doesn't support the language that you're using or that your teams are using? Or maybe most of your teams are using one language, but this other team over here is using something else. That becomes an issue. You also run into the same challenge of depth versus breadth. And if you've watched the other videos, you would have seen this little chart already. So this is a repeat. But you have the depth versus breadth issue. And so what I mean by that is, for any given language, there's a lot of nuance. And how well are you really digging into the details of every little nuance of this given application? Are you going really, really deep on that app, on that language? Or are you just trying to support all of the languages at a certain level? Now, ultimately, with enough time and resources, you could probably do depth and breadth, but it's really hard. And so vendors that have a massive list of languages they support have probably gone on the breadth model. The ones that have very few, they're probably going on the depth. They're trying to do the few well. What's right or wrong is difficult to say because it kind of depends on your own environment. What if you've got teams that are using all the languages out there, and so you just need somebody that's covering the breadth so I don't have to have, you know, three or four vendors in there doing the same thing. So it kind of depends on your situation. But be aware that this is a challenge and how and trying to discover from the vendor how well they've gone on the breadth versus depth. You know, it depends on how candid they will be and how much the salesperson's going to even know. So trying to dig into that would be something that I would recommend. The other thing that's a challenge is, and I'm not sure how they're going to resolve this in the long run here, but the way people build applications now, I think, is starting to cause an issue for IaaS, because you have a bunch of these microservices. People build all these tiny little pieces, or developers and companies are building a whole bunch of little pieces that cobble together to become one app. But one app is broken up into these pieces. And so you have to be able to get the instrumentation on each layer or each little microservice. And that becomes a challenge, I think. Again, if you're not developing that way, if you're not building in these microservices models, then IaaS may be fantastic for you. Again, this is just so you are aware, this is not beating up on anybody. All these products are going to have their challenges, all these categories of products. Why this product solution rocks? I think the ability to watch the executing code in real time is amazing. Like it solves so many problems because you can actually see what's going on. You're watching the execution. You can pinpoint problems. You can, when you see problems, you can get stack trace data and kind of like a SAST, you can actually give the developer often lines of code to actually look at to go fix the problem. That's amazing. That's huge. So remediation tends to be really, really good. I especially think it's really powerful if you combine it with the other products. So if you bring in a SAST product, then I think that's going to be super powerful, because you could bring it, like if you're bringing in a DAST and you're scanning it while it's running, I think that combination is especially compelling to me. Nobody's really doing that well yet, but that's a compelling solution. So when it's combined, and I do think that for the future of AppSec, I think IAST is one of the key future, like it's going to be a key component of the future of AppSec. We need it. We need it to continue to get better, because that's really one of the best places to see what's going on. Again, it has all of its challenges, but it has a lot of help there too. So I think that's part of what makes it amazing. And that's why I'm excited about IAST, but also wary of its limitations. Anyway, if you want to continue the conversation around the AppSec products, the next one is going to be around SCA, and we're going to be talking about the opportunity we have there. But join us again for the continued conversation. We're going to go all the way through it again. It's eight parts on all of the products. I think we're going to do a ninth episode, which is going to be a recap. And I'm hoping to bring in some guests, and we're going to kind of debate the issue a little bit. But thank you for joining. See you next time.